I'm Mark Tveau. I'm going to talk to you about curating the city. So there's been a long tradition of curating place. You see, actually, the National Park was doing it back in the teens, as we all know. We learned last night the kind of ranger mode. To me, I began this because cities are living museums. I see cities as living museums that are layered with narratives, multiple narratives about place. And I was inspired by the novelist Italo Calvino in the book Invisible Cities. And I just want to read this. The city, however, does not tell its past, but contains it like the lines of a hand, written into the corners of the streets, the gratings of the windows, the banisters of the steps, and the antenna of the lightning rods, the poles of the flags, every segment marked in turn with scratches, indentations, and scrolls. And I think it's our job as curators, which has become the buzz of the digital humanities, to bring those states to life. So I think cities can be like a museum. And as we create a tour, we're engaged in this act of curation. As you've heard, curation has lots of components. It's interpretive, it creates meaning, it builds community. I think that building community is a big part. I don't actually think about, as you'll see in a second, mobile in terms of marketing, but mobile in terms of building community. It's a kind of activist model. It's deeply collaborative and performative, it's active. And it's about teaching and learning. Everything we're doing is about that, and I would remind us of that. So my work began a long time ago, curating a series of sculptural gardens in Cleveland. Then it went to creating interpretive content for history kiosks that would be on a main bus route in Cleveland. That project, the Euclid Corridor project, came online just as the iPhone was emerging. And we said to ourselves at that point, oh, darn, wouldn't it be great to take those stories into the streets, into the community? So we did, and Cleveland Historical was that first project, but we built it in such a way, and Mark, did the NEH fund Omeka? I don't know if Mark's still there, but I think the NEH funded Omeka, which is an open source content management system. And when we built Cleveland Historical, we used this open source content management system from the Center for History and New Media as a way of thinking about whether we could extend the work from Cleveland to the kinds of projects other folks were doing. So CuratescaPE was born, and it was actually born as a process with partners in Spokane and Baltimore and New Orleans. And we use, and we are a series essentially of plugins for Omeka, as well as a data stream that goes to native mobile apps. And I can tell you, I go to the CuratescaPE's website, CuratescaPE.org, to learn more. But I want to talk to you about how we think about tours, as I mentioned before, when we work with partners. A good tour starts with a story. It also includes metadata. I'll say more about that in a second. But in thinking about those stories, we always encourage people to develop them in interpretive context. Those can be thematic, based on scholarship, or other ideas that people bring to the table. Back now to the wrong network. Don't need that. They can be geographic. It can be a neighborhood. It can be temporal, a tour of the 1920s, a tour of the 1960s. And it can also be spatial. And I'll talk more about the spatiality again a little bit later, but it's a theme I'll come back to again and again. The big thing everybody tells us about our phones is they're location aware. It's important to recognize what that location awareness is. It is a latitude and longitudinal point on the Earth, and it's almost always shown on a Google map. Those are all representations, and we shouldn't act as if there's some interpretation embedded naturally in that technology or in that physical location. There's that physical context of that spot will carry interpretation. But putting a point on a map is not ipso facto a given, and in fact is an active interpretation, which I'll suggest to you in a second. And finally, it's an active process. Here you see a tour group we work with in Phoenix and actually Tempe, leading a hybrid docent, it's a hybrid tour, docent and mobile assisted. And the idea that somebody, and I think Mike, it was suggested in the last session, articulately, somebody will just pick up your app and start running around the city is very unlikely. They have to be guided through it. And so that docent is an important part of the process. It's an active and critical part. So I want to start with scores. The idea I suggested before is that the stories EduRome is everything. That stories are in fact layers, and we get to choose the layers we tell. We have a series of tools we use to tell those stories. They include text. You saw some of that in Road Tour. They include images. Here's an image that was associated with the building of Shaker Heights, an elite planned community on the fringes of Cleveland. I would suggest that as curators and thinking about ourselves in that way, we really have to think about ourselves as makers, as people making choices. And we should choose images that aren't flat, that they themselves can help tell the story if that's possible. And this image tells the story of Shaker Heights. It is a city on the hill for the white upper middle class of the 1930s. Right? So there's something about that image that conveys meaning. Mark suggested the importance of sound this morning, and I want to play a quick clip, and I really want you to listen to the sound. I don't want you to look at the video, but let me make sure my sound is on correctly. I want you to listen to this sound.
Camp Mueller, Camp Rosetta, Camp Rosetta, really don't. Camp Mueller!
Camp Mueller, Camp Rosetta, Camp Rosetta, really don't.
Camp Mueller!
Mueller, how we love your name.
All right.
And we hope to bring you fame.
Camp Mueller, Camp Rosetta, Camp Rosetta, really young. Camp Mueller.
Word campers work.
Oh,
do your best. Dance and sing, you're better than the rest. La 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 la.
Camp Mueller.
La 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 la. Mueller, how we love your name,
and we hope to bring you fame. Camp Mueller, Camp Rosetta, Camp Rosetta, really gone.
Camp Mueller!
Camp Mueller is one of the first integrated summer camps in the Cuyahoga Valley in the Cleveland area. And these two women went to the camp in the early 1950s, and we met them at an event, and I did an oral history, and they both kept mentioning the song. And I said, well, why don't you sing it? And they said, you know, you heard them laugh. They laughed and said, sure, why not? And so they sang the song. And I think the sound conveys so much more than just who cares about the song. You can hear their joy, right? That's the value of the sound. And so oral history becomes part of that, can become part of that landscape. Think about connections, and here I was going to show, for the sake of time I won't show it, but an example of a connection. White Motors was a factory in the Cleveland area for a long time. They produced the buses that are used at Glacier National Park in Yellowstone, even today, these White Motors buses that were quintessential of the experience of tourists in the 1930s and 40s. So when we haven't done this on Cleveland Historical yet, but you can interpret the story of White Motors in multiple ways and layers. One of them could be the story of the workers at the factory. Another layer could could be the story of tourism in the West and how white motors structured it. But it's a way to make connections beyond the places, that, beyond the physical location, to the broader set of the ways in which our lives structure the places in which we live. We heard the Camp Mueller song in terms of thinking about the power of voices. Now I want to play for you, and hopefully you're now connected to the Brown Network. The idea of a hook. And so you're all quite aware of the story of Cleveland, a mistake on the lake, as it used to be known. One of the reasons it was known in this fashion is because the Cuyahoga River often caught fire and was an important feature of the early work of the EPA. When the river caught fire, it became a national endeavor. And we did an oral history, and I won't get a chance to play it here, but in which an activist on the river for 30 years recalls working along the river and how you don't fall in the river. That became a hook for a series of stories along the Cuyahoga. And the question that I would ask you is, where do you place a story like that? The best, it's located physically on the river, but how do you connect people to that space? We saw the Urban Rangers take us into the Los Angeles River. The Cuyahoga River is best accessed on a boat. So is it a boat tour? So those are the kinds of thoughts that go into where you put a marker. And so we have it located on a bank where it's physically accessible by car, because we didn't want, the only way people would connect is via the river. We have a series of training materials that speak to the anatomy of a story. And so I'm gonna show a few of those. Those are on the CuriateScape website. I'm going to show a few of them right now. So you saw Road Tour. Most of the web, this is the web app side of things. And most everything, in order for it to work, and this is true of everybody's project, everybody's projects you see here, anybody who uses digital. Oops.
Scary. Oops, I don't know. There's a lot of
Okay, don't fall in the river. Let's go back to that real quick.
All know about the river fire of 69, and as somebody who's interested in the history of Cleveland and Cuyahoga River, I know that wasn't the best fire. I know there was other fires that could have burned down Cleveland had not the wind shifted from the north. I remember a 52 fire attack that was, I think that one probably would have won the prize for the best fire. I was actually working the day that the river caught on fire, and actually working as a hatch tender on the ships. So it's kind of unusual when somebody would yell fire and tell you to run away from the river. Because the river is generally water. But when you were working down on the river at that time, the river was like a cauldron. It would just bubble up oxygen trying to get out of the river. It had a coat of oil on it. And you'd see rats float down the river the size of dogs, bloated from whatever it was that they ingested. And there was a rule that if you fell in the river, you immediately went to the emergency room in the hospital. So the idea here was don't fall in the river.
And so that story actually illustrates the problem even beautifully about where do you put the pins. Because almost all those pins are in industrial areas that are not immediately accessible. So when we look at a story, they all have metadata. They all have metadata, and Omeka uses Dublin Core, so we keep the Dublin Core metadata. Dublin Core is a kind of typical archival standards-based approach to library metadata. And these metadata is really important because that's what helps make our projects sustainable as well. Because as long as you have really well-structured data, you can both save it and port it to a platform in the future. It's when you don't have that structured data that you begin to have problems. So in this case, we've told people where, and I'm going to show you the back end in 2 seconds, where each of these fields are in a series of slides. Metadata is also important because it helps with discovery. We allow people to append subjects and tags to each of their entries, and we encourage them to use controlled subjects. That gives the project some control, but then user-generated tags that just let people freeform do it. And if you click on the tags and subjects, it allows people a vehicle to explore your data, to explore your stories in ways that you might not otherwise have thought about. And through your analytics later on, you get to actually see that, to see if in fact what the search terms people are using are. And that can help you plan the future. Organizing image and sound files, make choices. Here, you see a variety of different sorts of images, including sandboard maps, but we've discovered that people love newspaper articles. In fact, the first time a student wanted to put a newspaper article in the story, I said, no way, that's boring. But it turns out people love that. Because we're building, as I'm going to tell you more about in a second, context for our reader, for our users. And then finally, there's a series of file details you put together with the images, all of which is really important for the community as it kind of both comes to you as an expert and then seeks to do more research. I'm going to show you very quickly what the back end will look like. And it looks like any other content management system you've ever seen if you've used them. So all you do is do this kind of standard admin. And it logs you in and you see what is. I have master user privileges for the Salt River Stories project. And you see a whole a bunch of fields. And basically, the key one is items. And these are all of our stories. We've kept the Omeka nomenclature here rather than change it. But for us, an item is a story. Each story is a compound archival object. Many projects would think about a single picture or a single piece of text on a pin. But thinking about the item as a compound object, multiple things, really encourages our users to think about telling a story, to make an argument. And here's a bunch that are in process. These are private. And then there's some at the bottom that are public. And if I were to click on one of these, let's find one that I like. It is essentially text, each in a control field. I can click edit up here. I've given it subject, so you can, I can go through it all, but I'm not going to go through all the details. We've uploaded files, and we do that through when we hit the edit button. We can change the various item types, the files, we can add tags, we put it on a map. This is all that's happening in just about any system like this. Now, that's for developing the stories. Each tour, then, essentially is built by, I'm going to edit it. It gives some description. I prepared that. This is a tour for us. You're going to see in a second. So I can change any of these fields. It'll show up on the app or on the web immediately. And then, if I hit items, I get to choose the stories that go into it. So what we suggest to people is to think about not just a single story, but multiple stories connected by a theme or a geography. So this is really all the harder it is technically to create the story. And this, I think, emphasizes what's really important to us is that kind of process, that interpretation. So I want to go back to that. The interpretive process demands that we look at the physical landscape and take account of it. Curation, as I've suggested, is interpretation. The city is a context. I loved the way you could get in the Doric, right? Use the physicality of the city, the way the rangers use the physicality of the city to tell a story. I think it's important that not all tours, as Susan suggested, are walking. They can be driving. They can be biking. The scale of the tour conveys meaning. How could you do a suburb, a tour of the suburbs, without getting in a car? Right? Can you do a walking tour of the suburbs? Maybe a shopping mall. Research context matters, both hyper-local, but also our scholarly work. But more important than even both of those things is the fact, and this is the hardest thing, because we have to teach students, is to get them to take a position, make an argument, have a voice. We saw that yesterday, yesterday evening. Each of those projects had a powerful voice that unified them. Larry Sabula in Spokane created, in a series of blog posts, what I think are the best models for creating a tour, a historic tour, where he charged his students with identifying ghost signs in Spokane and building a tour of the very best one. And they did it both for Spokane Historical, but then through a series of walking tours. And as we think about that tour and make our choices, we really need to think about stops on the tour, nodes, places where our stories might come together, and the path we're going to take, as you've seen everybody thinks about here today. And we need to think about connecting to our communities. And I want to emphasize three things. Docents are a powerful vehicle for that. We were surprised, because we had bought all the rhetoric about mobile when we first did this, and not a lot of people were using Cleveland Historic. We thought people would discover us and then go out on these individual walking tours. Not the case. In fact, it was only after we began working with docent-led tours that we discovered people began to use the app both to support the tour. The older you were, the less likely you were when the docent was there to have your phone go. The younger folks would look at photos as the docent was speaking, maybe a here and before and after, or then and now type photo. But the docent-led tours gave it an event and a life. It also turned out that it helped us extend community relationships we already had and build new ones, both of which were really powerful. In one neighborhood in Cleveland, a local judge began to, who had been funding historic preservation and who was a preservationist himself, began funding a graduate student to help bring that community to life, and it led to a register nomination for the district. So that relationship was not just one where we were supporting the tour, but we were working to build it with the community, which is what generated our audience. One of the values of the marketing materials that we heard about earlier was not just that they let people know to come to the tour, but they provided a touchstone after the tour. And in fact, the use of QR codes or beacons, as I'm going to show in a second, are sometimes as important for what they do afterwards than in generating audience. So here is an example of a tour brochure on the right that we handed out that it was sufficiently beautiful where people would put it up on refrigerators. And the idea is that people would then use the tour brochure to go back and look at the website later on. So they came to the web after having taken a physical tour. And in a sense, I think tour is as being an act of public performance, it's an activist act. Docents are trained curators. Tours express organizational connections. Promotion and marketing are really about teaching. They're not just about getting people to use your material. They're about teaching them both to you how to use the tour, but also history and about the place. And this kind of legacy interpretation that I just suggested to you becomes a touchstone. So examples of legacies we've left in Cleveland. With one Main Street community, Cleveland Heights, these are window planes. What you see on the right is put over a clear kind of, I guess it's kind of a fold, it adheres to a window, and that's what you might see on the building. People don't discover us this way, but it begins to create a relation between the business, the street, and the interpretation. Here are a series of tour cards we did in Shaker Heights as they were celebrating their centennial. In Tempe, we have a partner who's been active in creating the light rail connections to Mesa. And we have a QR code. We were sort of an afterthought, but we're a QR code on the bottom right. The point of that is not immediately to send people to Salt River Stories, the app, our app, but it's rather to start beginning to build a relationship. And finally, we produced in limited numbers, I wish we had done more, materials for teaching. These are placards that you could send out to a classroom where a teacher who can't go into the community necessarily with their students, or as we heard yesterday with Holly, maybe they do send their students into the community, but they come back and they look at images and they use their phones. Every student, no matter how wealthy they are anymore, has a phone. And they can use them in a class and do a kind of scavenger hunt around the class if you handed enough of these out to teachers. And the web serves as a follow-up. So finally, we began this project with a very modest set of goals that gradually scaled up. We now have 60,000 Gradescape apps that have been downloaded, 600,000 unique web visitors a year to the various projects. Our web analytics, as you'll see here in a second, suggest a kind of user flow through the material, right? And so we can follow how people are using, what they're looking at, where they're using it, who's using it, and how they're going through the material. Google Historical now gets about half of those 600,000 annual visitors. And a small percentage, 8 or 10%, will spend 15 or 20 minutes reading the material, which is a lot of time. And so our question is always, how do we grow that? So that's a quick look inside what we do. I'm happy to take a couple questions. So thank you.
Thank you.
So there's a scholar at UMass who has deployed a Gradescape site and he's working with the students, and it's just on the web. And that itself is a really, you know, kind of a great training experience. It doesn't cost a thing. What I liked about what Morgan said earlier is all the planning the Rhode Island Historical Society went into did at first. I think if you really thought about what you want to do, it's pretty quick. It happens pretty quickly. My best students could get a tour up in a week.
So is this sort of comparable to building a website, a simple website?
Well, no, because it's all packaged. It's sort of like going to WordPress.com and just, I mean, the hardest thing is getting the logo. There's a logo and an identity a project needs. Like, Road Tour is a really good one. And that probably took a while to figure out. Cleveland Historical didn't take us much time because it was simple, but that title was also limiting. So I think the answer is it probably takes, you can get a tour up and working in a week with kind of a rookie team. If you have an experienced team, you can do it in a few days. The problem isn't the technology. That turns out is easy to teach. It's the kind of conceptual vehicle. What's the function of the tour? And I think we've, you know, heard a lot about that.
My name is Greg DeNelfrio. I'm here from the University of Minnesota. I wanted to ask a question about the technology. I'm familiar vaguely with Omeka, but somebody recently told me, well, Scalar is a more powerful tool than Omeka. And I wonder if you have feelings about this versus that platform.
I used to. I've stopped having feelings about those because it occurs to me that platform is less important to the work of the new tour in concept. And so that's the first, I guess, thing. We use Omeka because it's a standards-based archive. And all the data that Morgan creates and the center here create for Road Tour will last forever and can be ported somewhere else. Scalar, last I looked, although I think they're correcting this, doesn't have as rich an archival backend as no backup. I think that's true, but there are lots. I just don't want to be on the record saying anything bad about anybody else in the digital universe.
All right,
and by the way, St. Paul and Minneapolis each have a Minneapolis Historical and St. Paul Historical, and never the twain shall meet.
No, of course.
I can hear you.
My question is about the maps. Are they stationary, or do they, can you put in the route and be able to follow yourself and make sure that you're on the right path?
Yeah, so both on the mobile app, you can get directions to wherever you're going. And we're working on a change to show the physical path. But we also have discovered, and I actually want to point out a couple really important things, features that came out of our user experience. We discovered that people don't always like the map. Seeing pins on a map is actually bewildering. Seeing pins with a path, if you don't want to take that path, turns you off. The map may be a larger impediment to people's adopting these kinds of technologies, in my opinion, than you might think. That is why we added the view a random story feature, because we found that lots of people just like to surf the data. They love the way we tell stories and the student voices. So they'll just view a random story, or they'll find a student they like Heidi, and they'll find everything that Heidi, all 22 stories that Heidi creates, and follow Heidi around. I mean, it's really, it's a, what people do is amazing. We're trying to give them flexibility.
Just to follow on that, I was just wondering if you could speak to the comment you made very early that a point on a map is not, or is an active interpretation, but is, I can't remember exactly what you said, but it was very provocative, and I wanted you to talk a little bit more about it.
Yeah, and we started last night to talk. I was commented to you that I love the way some of the maps that the rangers are deploying put unusual icons to alert you to the way nature is happening in cities, right? We often don't look at a Google map as if, we look at it as if it's reality, not that it's a representation of reality. And very few people actually really question that representation. So it, to me, we have our Baltimore project keeps wanting us to use OpenStreetMaps so that they can create a layer that where the map layer provides interpretation. And so the idea is that wouldn't it be great if we could explode that map layer itself and make people view the landscape as an interpretive, maps as an interpretation. And I worry about it with Google, because let's go Google it. There's just some magic that it's not interpretive or media.
How do you spell Omeka?
O-M-E-K-A.
O-M-E-K-A.
O-M-E is an Edward.
Okay. And what do you know about Esri story maps?
Story maps? Those are the ones that occur, you can make time, you can make them change over time. Story maps is a pretty nice project where you can show maps changing over time. It's really just a digital project. I haven't seen a mobile manifestation of it, but I'm sure something like that would eventually have its own mobile expression.
Mark, thank you very much.